Very good afternoon. To begin with, I would like to convey my sincere thanks to the organizer for having given me an opportunity to be here. My topic, which has been given to me, is sustainable development and management of water resources, the challenge and the roadmap part. I'll straight away come to the challenge part, and I'll put it slightly differently. To me, the biggest challenge is in actually understanding the challenge, or that has become the problem, that how really do you understand this water resource paradigm, the development and the management paradigm. I understand that this issue of understanding in the sense of, the verb, not the knowledge part. We have ample knowledge, but the understanding as a process is somewhere which gets, little difficult. Now, this understanding is somewhere related to the concept of what we call as the perception. The way we perceive thing actually leads to our understanding. And since we all perceive things differently, the very same thing looks different from each individual's or the entity level understanding. So we live in a kind of a paradigm which is different for each entity or each individual. And in that kind of a scenario, we find it difficult to have a kind of a roadmap which is agreeable to all, or a step which you can take collectively and move in certain direction. If I would like, because my experience with this gathering, my previous experiences with this gathering has been in such that I find a lot of speaker talk referring to mythology and Vedas, etc. So I thought this time I will also do the same thing. So from that concept, the notion which I am talking about, the perception, it's something which very early civilization has been realizing, that we have this issue of perception. We conceive the whole world, which we refer as Maya, by individual's perception. And typically in Hindi, the word used is bhag, that is, my part of the perception becomes the bhag, and someone who can come across or who can integrate all these perceptions is called Bhagwan. That's how we actually overcome the bottleneck of our perceived paradigm. Now, what are these perceptions which actually stop us from moving forward or really understanding the paradigm of water resources development? I'm picking up only three such perceptions which I would like to share with you, and very well I can make it clear that I am also only giving one part of the perception. So it's not that I am going to oppose a perception of somebody else, but I'm only trying to give one more perception which may cut across many perceptions. The first perception which I want to highlight is the notion that water is scarce. This is something which I have been talking for a long time, and one simple logic which I try to put across is that what is the benchmark by which we carry this kind of a perception that the water is scarce on this planet Earth? In fact, there is no other planet, at least till now, where we have been able to even find some kind of a, water in that kind of a form which exists in India. So we don't have a benchmark even to make a comparison or to conclude that the water is scarce. In that kind of a scenario, we have been just perceiving that water is scarce and doing so many things which are contradictory to the very concept of nature or the prakriti. You know, the water, we all know that somewhere around 97% water is sea water. It's only about another 2.5% is fresh water, but it's in the form of frozen water, which is not available to us. So roughly 0.5% of water is what we can consider as available, but out of that also 90% is in the form of aquifer water, deep ground water, which again is not something which we consider as available for what we call as the annual or recurring use. So maybe less than 0.05% of water is we are talking about. And I want to tell you that even this 0.05% of water is not scarce. Even this is available in sufficient quantity, may not be abundant, but sufficient quantity, simply because of a factor called reusability or recyclability. It is the same water which you are using again and again. So the number as such is not really the matter. It is the way it gets recycled and becomes available to you naturally. That makes all the difference. It's just like a money multiplier effect. All the things which we are seeing in terms of demonetization is simply because we have taken away the means of multiplier effect. Same thing can happen with water. Or in a reverse way, since this multiplier effect is available, we do not really have that kind of a scarcity which somewhere in our back of mind we are perceiving. It's estimated that world over the water resource is of the order of something like 42,000 kilometer cube, or what we say, billion cubic meter BCM. Out of that 42,000 BCM, which is the annual renewable water, that is what we consider as sufficient. In fact, I have been reading somewhere which says that it is sufficient almost 40 times more than our need even in 2050. This is globally I am talking about. Out of this water, about 1900 BCM is available to our country. Now, this is roughly 4.6% of the global water, whereas our land proportion is only about 2.2%. In fact, we have been endowed with much more water than the many of the countries. World has only about 10 countries which has access to something like 60% of this renewable water resource. And India is one of these 10 countries. We are not really scarce. Even if you look at the global terms also, we are not really scarce in terms of water resources. But we are the one who carry this perception as though water is very, very scarce. In this water, about 1123 BCM, which is roughly 60% of the water I'm talking about, is considered as utilizable. And out of this utilizable component, around 60% is considered as surface water and around 40% becomes a groundwater. But this surface and groundwater which I am talking about, or which is part of what we call as the plant water usable water, that is actually part of the same water. It is coming out of the annual rainfall of what we estimate as 4000 BCM. Whatever groundwater we have been talking about as part of our plan to achieve is that water which is part of the annual recyclable water. Anything which is in the deep aquifer is not part of our problem or the solution paradigm at all. We have not been talking about it, but we have been using that. So this access to the groundwater which is deep, which is not part of our annual recyclable water, is called groundwater mining, which again is not something which we have consider as part of a solution, but still we are going ahead with that. Now, this scarcity which I have been talking about leads to some kind of a skewed development. What exactly is happening with this scarcity mindset? To begin with, this scarcity mindset leads to classes of have and have nots. Someone who has doesn't want to change his proportion or the excess. He is not willing to dilute his existing rights. And someone who perceives as being on the have-not side wants to all the time increase his share. This conflict of have and have-not makes us in a kind of a situation where we are just not able to move forward. And that's what we are seeing, all the problem, whether it's between Karnataka and Tamil Nadu or it is between Punjab and Haryana. It's part of the same equation. Not only we are not able to move forward, we are creating problems and problems which are actually becoming impossible to resolve. Even we are ending up with constitutional crisis, and nobody really knows that will we ever be able to overcome these hurdles. We are actually only deferring the problem. Everyone is trying to only overcome the current paradigm of conflict, but not resolving the conflict, because the conflict is centered in this scarcity mindset which we are not able to change. Then we have another problem with this mindset, that is generating a bad competition. There are two types of competition. One is good, one is bad. The good competition actually always raises the bar, something like what we see in the sports field where two players compete all the time, the records keep on going up and up. But a bad competition is such where at a higher level, everything is actually a lose-lose scenario. Even if the two competitors can see win and lose game, but in reality, at the social level, at the national level, at the global level, we are actually a loser. It's something like if two children within a family are fighting, even if they go to a court case, one will win, another will lose. But the parents definitely are going to lose, irrespective of the fact who is winning. So at national level, when all these states are fighting with each other, taking up all their unresolved issues to the level of court, and all the time someone is winning and declaring and celebrating, the country is losing in any case. So that bad competition is also coming out of this scarcity mindset. Having said that, I'll move to the second perception. The second perception is that the dam and no dam debate is a central theme to the development, as though it is needed. I mean, you have to overcome this step so as to move forward. Now, having said that the water is not scarce in this country, still we have a problem. In fact, we have two problems. The first problem is something related to the population pressure, which directly affects what we call as the water stress. That is, though the water is sufficient, but the per capita availability of this annual water is declining all the time because population is growing all the time. So that leads to what we call as the water scarcity. So that is one part of the problem. The second part of the problem is that the water is not available uniformly, neither in terms of space nor in terms of time. Almost 80% of the water is available only in 4 months of the monsoon. Out of that also, it's not uniform. In fact, 50% of the water is available only for 15 days. Or even in terms of time, even it is not even 15 days, in less than 100 hours, you are actually getting 50% of the rainfall. Geographically, around 65% of the water is available to around 30% of the landmass. Balance has to cope up with only 35% of the share. Now, that skewed availability of water brings us a different kind of a challenge set. Now, dams are nothing but a means to overcome this skewed distribution. First, you need water in any case because the population pressure is demanding that. Secondly, you need water at a particular space and also at a particular time. So dam is nothing but that kind of an instrument which makes it happen. It's something like in your house, if you have tap available in the bathroom but you need water in the balcony, then you will use a bucket to take that water to that balcony. That bucket is nothing but a dam. If the water supply is not available to you 24 hours, suppose it comes only 2 hours a day, then what do? You need bucket or you need a bigger drum. And it also depends on the number of people within the household. Are you one person? Are you a five-member family? That will also decide the size of the bucket. So dam is nothing but that kind of a bucket. It's not creating a problem in itself. It's only part of a solution. So the problem of having this no dam or dam versus debate is causing a lot of issues. Number one, whatever projects have been going on, some of the mega projects, they have been put on the hold. Or even if they are moving at such a pace that we cannot call them, they are giving a viable solution. And secondly, whatever could have been made in terms of new resources or new surface water resources, we have put it on the back burner. We are just not even talking about it. Okay. So I'll come to the third perception. I'll skip the roadmap. So the third perception which I am talking about is something related to a statement which we keep on using, that water resource development is engineering centric, hence it is a problematic. Now what exactly is this notion which we are carrying? The problem is not with the engineering, but the problem is with the development. You know, development which has been there, right? You know, the very nature is what we say time immemorial. It is sanatan, it is beyond the time. It is only human and the development of human civilization which has got a linkage with the time. In fact, they say Brahma created the Brahman, but Brahma actually not created the Brahman. Possibly Brahma created the civilization. That is the intervention when the Brahma comes as a creator. In fact, they say after creating Brahma, Brahma became some kind of a, you know, panicky, and then Vishnu stepped in to make sure that his creation can sustain. In fact, if you at all you want to look at engineering, it is that part of, you know, Vishnu's role. If the problem is created by development, it is Vishnu, which is engineering, which is going to give you the solution. A solution which can overcome the problem, that is engineering. And in case it is not able to overcome that problem, then it is a fault implementation of the engineering, but not engineering per se, which is the cause of the problem. So we have issues. We have issues related to engineering which have come in the whole process, and we say let the engineering per se development has to stop. Then there is no development possible. Or if whatever development will happen, that will be actually causing much more problem than we can solve. In fact, we have gone to such an extent that we have been saying stop the engineering. In fact, very early, the integrated water resource development and management used to be the keyword, IWRDM. And today we have dropped the word D and we simply say integrated water resource management, as though you can live without that development being there, because you are actually opposing the development That is why you are doing all this kind of a thing. In fact, they say that Shiva is the one who has been against Brahma, who is the creator of the problem, and he cuts off the head of Brahma. The fifth head of the Brahma is cut off by the Shiva, and that way IWRDM is also a five-letter word, and the D has been cut off. Okay, the problem of engineering is actually in reality, I will not say that there are no problems. We have misfired engineering for many reasons. One of the reasons is that we really do not have that kind of organizational structure, process, or the control which this institution can make a difference with. Secondly, our efforts are compartmentalized. They are in compartment. I am saying efforts are in compartment. I am not worried about the knowledge being in compartment. But to integrate this knowledge and have a unified way, that is where we are not able to make a difference. So that compartmentalization in terms of effort is another problem. And the third problem is that organization is losing the character. Now, I have been, yeah. Okay, thank you.